Hello and welcome to Idnell's Crafting. I'm Lily, and this project started out with the idea that I wanted to be able to have a place to put my paints so I wouldn't risk spilling anything. But if you didn't already know, I have this crazy habit of always getting sidetracked. And I figured that if I'm gonna make a small holder to use while I'm painting, then of course I also have to make a stand for those paints I'm not currently using. You know, it made sense to me at least. So anyways, here we go. I moved over to my usual workspace and pulled out more foam board to use as a base for this project. My plan is to have the front-facing parts look like rocks, and to be able to do that later on, I'm removing the outer layer of the foam board on these specific pieces. Since I can't draw or cut a straight line to save my life, I'm just eyeballing everything and not actually relying too much on measurements. And since the front will be covered by rock-like texture, it doesn't seem like the end of the world if not everything is completely straight or have clean cuts. I'm using toothpicks and superglue to attach everything, and if you want to make something similar, don't forget to be very careful since the superglue doesn't dance well together with the foam. So I recommend using, like a mask? Or stand outside? I mean, I'm sure you'll be able to figure something out, just don't breathe in those fumes. They're bad for you. Technically, I could have been almost done with the project at this point, only needing to add some texture and paint. But since I'm me, I really want to add a guardian dragon as well. Of course. I made a crazy mess of my workspace when creating this paint stand, so a little cleaning up is in order before I can start working on the dragon. And of course, there is time for some cuddling too. Aww. I have an idea of how I want the dragon to pose, and to try to get it roughly the way I want it, I'm starting with making some easy armature using metal wire and aluminum foil. It may not make much sense at this point, but at least it's a good base for me to start adding clay. By the way, in the background today is this amazing glass painting of Sailor Moon and Little Luna that my lovely daughter made for me. I love it, and my daughter is such a huge inspiration for me. I'm starting the slow process of covering a part of the armature with polymer clay, shaping scales, putting it in the oven, and then cover the next part, and shaping scales, and then returning it to the oven. Luckily, nothing bad happens if you bake the same thing several times. The only thing that could happen, really, is that the white could turn more yellow, but honestly, I tend not to use much white clay anyways. So I use this technique where I complete a part of the dragon and then put it in the oven to avoid that something breaks or gets squished. Mainly because I don't want to risk that I get too sidetracked at some point and accidentally make a huge fingerprint somewhere, causing myself to waste valuable time when I have to redo huge parts. I'm also adding some belly scales at this point, hoping that this little fella is gonna start to look more like a dragon and less like a radioactive fish. A big part of the belly scales has already been in the oven here, so you can see a slight color difference between those scales and the brand new ones. Don't worry about that though, all clay changes color slightly when it's in the oven, and as long as the original pre-baked color is the same, the outcome will be the same too. I have on purpose made very ugly marks on the neck, back, and tail. This is so that the liquid polymer will be able to grab on and make sure the more colorful scales will stick and not risk falling off in the future. Now when the body is completed, it's time to start sculpting the head. I want him to have his mouth open, almost like he's gonna bite anyone that comes too close. You know, you gotta protect those Games Workshop paints. But, okay, for real, I'm deciding to take it slow and steady, and creating one layer at a time, basically. Also making sure to use a bunch of the teeth that were left over after making the Nurgle Spawn Mr. Potato. They fit this guy pretty well in size, I think. And to top it all off for this layer, he now has a tongue with some liquid polymer clay on that hopefully will cure to look like dripping drool. Whoa. Time to add some structure to his lower jaw. And of course, someone could argue that a dragon should have scales all the way, but I find it highly unlikely that a dragon would need to protect their throat from other predators. Like, I mean, they have claws and teeth and wings and, I mean, some of them even breathe fire. So wouldn't it be more logical if it's elastic? But then again, I guess since snakes can like unhinge their jaws and stretch out so much that it looks like their skin is gonna break at any second, then maybe it could like have scales all the way. But do we know if dragons actually shed their skin? Like, is that a thing? I might be overthinking this a little bit. Now when the lower jaw has been in the oven, I'm adding a basic shape to the top part of the head. This is just an extra layer that will hold the horns in place and does not have any real details. Also decided for a couple of eyes for him. Even though many of the eyes that I use in my crafts are handmade, these aren't. The horns are also made from polymer clay, but a slightly different kind. It's called Fimo leather, and it needs to be on a slightly higher heat in the oven to cure. But the nice thing with it is that when it is cured, it's possible to bend it. The reason to why I want to use this for horns is that if this fellow would fall on the floor at some point in the future, it has a bigger chance to not break if the parts sticking out aren't completely firm. I'm making sure the scale pattern continues up on the face to make sure that it all blends together in a nice way. He's now a really handsome and vicious looking little fella. And I decided to show a work-in-progress sneak peek to show off how scary-looking he already is. It's time to give him a pair of wings. It took me a while to decide on the right size, but when I did, I made him wings by shaping metal wire roughly how I would like the wings to be positioned. Hopefully he'll end up looking less cute and more vicious after this. Since the wings will be sticking out quite a bit as well, I'm making them from the leather version of Fimo. Starting with a pair that are of equal size and shaping them slightly differently to fit his pose. By the way, I named him Devon. Devon the Guardian. The body and head is complete. And the wings are cooling down after being in the oven. So now it's a good time to give Devon paws. I'm adding a small metal wire in all the paws just to make sure that he has the little extra stability. Shaping them to at this point look like little alien feet, but the plan is to add a claw on every little toe. Kira wants to go to bed, so she did the next best thing and just grabbed a blanket and lay down under my desk. And I still want to continue with the claws, so I'm not gonna go to bed just yet. Okay, now it's time for bed. Finishing those little paws felt so nice. Devon is really getting closer and closer to being done now. And he's starting to look pretty damn vicious too, right? Right? Anyone that uses polymer clay on a regular basis already know that you likely spend more time mixing colors than you actually do sculpting. Or who knows? Perhaps I'm the only one that don't want to use those basic colors that you can purchase. For the scales that will go up his entire spine, I mixed three different colors and decided to combine them looking like they are faded into each other. Magic. Remember how I made those ugly markings on his back? Now I can use some random discarded clay together with a small layer of liquid polymer clay, and then start working on the back scales over this. The reason to why I do it this way instead of using liquid polymer clay as a kind of glue under every scale is that I want to make sure that everything is attached in a good way and nothing falls off later on. The three colors I mixed together earlier was squeezed out to a few canes, then cut into roughly the same size pieces. Taking every piece and gently roll it to more of a cone shape, then put it with a good side down and squish it against the table. I then shape it to resemble a feather or a leaf. If you want to try something similar, don't feel limited to how I make them. The possibilities are endless. You can shape them however you want, but personally, I would just want to recommend that you try to make sure that all of them look more or less the same. Like for Devon, I made 5 little lines on each side of the middle on every single scale. If some would have had 2 lines and some 8 lines, it would look rather weird when all were attached. But I guess it's a matter of personal taste too. I might just be too OCD to be able to have the scales look that different. Devon is actually completely done now, wings and all. The only thing he is missing is the paint stand that he is to guard. So it's time to start on the rock wall. I'm tracing out where I'd like the rocks to be and start to add small dabs of modeling paste. But I quickly realize that it's way easier to just smush on that paste in a thin layer over the entire area and then trace out where the gaps between the rocks should be. I've never really used modeling paste much. I kind of just bought it because it looked like a cool addition to my crazy crafting corner. But it does say on the package that it is
for building up heavy layers of structure on canvas. Paint with art acrylic after drying.
And that sounds pretty decent, right? Anyways, I added a lot of extra modeling paste on some of the rocks to try to get more of a 3D effect while still trying not to interfere too much with the space that the paints need. In hindsight, I probably should have read the
building up
line a little more, since I just slabbed on a whole bunch and ended up having to wait 2 full days for it to dry completely. So, note to self, thin layers dry super quick, huge blobs does not. Since my normal black spray can ran out of color as soon as I was gonna use it, I used Citadel's Chaos Black as base. This doesn't melt the foam board that I'm using, but if you're gonna try to spray any kind of foam with anything, always make sure to test it on a small piece first, so that your awesome project doesn't get destroyed by something so unfortunate. I'm using Citadel's layer paint Storm Vermin Fur for this first layer, but I'm not pure dry brushing, it's more like a mix between normal painting and dry brushing, because at this point I just want to get the rocks to have a more solid color, you know, less black and more fur, apparently. I'm going over with Cadian flesh tone on some of the rocks so they don't all look exactly the same, and then dry brushing properly with Ushabti Bone and Ceramite White. Fur, flesh, and bone. Quite fitting. Before I show you the final result and Devon in his final form, I just want to take a quick moment and thank you so much for watching this video. And don't forget to like the video and subscribe to the channel if you want to see more content like this. Anyways, have an awesome day, stay safe, and enjoy the final result. I'll see you next time. Bye! You know, you gotta protect those gee-wee paints. Gee-wee! I can't fucking do this. Gee-wee! Taking every piece and gentry. Taking every piece and gentry. I keep saying gentry.